These are African rhythms, passed down to us through ancient spirits. Feel the spirit, a unifying force. Come on, move with the spirit. Stand up, clap your hands. Groove with the rhythms, get down.
From WSNC 90.5 FM, a broadcasting service and NPR affiliate of Winston-Salem State University, welcome to Africa World Now Project. I'm your host and producer, James Pope. Today, thinking through Black geographies, the right to food, memories of resistance and land, with Ashanté M. Reese, author of Black Food Geographies, Race, Self-Reliance, and Food Access in Washington, D.C. Africa World Now Project is next. Place, as understood in Africana deep thought and practice, is both material and non-material. The seed of humanity's ability to evolve is rooted in the practices that are intent to create a balance between this fact. Imbalance, consciously and unconsciously created, have deep implications on the lived realities of every community around the globe. Being so, the remedy to imbalance can also be located in mapping Africana praxis of resistance, of being. The root of current sociopolitical and cultural disorders can be traced to the processes of European projects that redefined the human and created justifications for the creation and maintenance of private property. There's little debate on this fact. Racial capitalism is not a simple economic system. It is ideological and cultural. It creates, orders, and structures life systems and polices the knowledge that is outside of these systems. Today, Africa Now and Africa World Now Project Collective's Tasneem Siddiqui is in conversation with Ashanté Reese. We will have the privilege to sit and listen to the minds of deeply intelligent, action-oriented educators, think through Black geographies, the right to food, memories of resistance, and the role of land and the scope and range of Africana freedom. Ashanté Reese is an assistant professor in the Department of Geography and Environmental Sciences at University of Maryland, Baltimore County. Ashanté earned her bachelor's degree in history with a minor in African American Studies from Trinity University in San Antonio, Texas. After graduating, she taught middle school at Coretta Scott King Leadership Academy. She later went on to earn her master's in public anthropology and a PhD from American University, specializing in race, gender, and social justice. Her work is situated around Black geography, specifically the ways Black people produce and navigate spaces and places in the context of anti-Blackness. While she is interested in and committed to documenting the ways anti-Blackness constrains Black life, she is ultimately intent to answer the question, what and who survives, including being a valued member of the Africa Now and Africa World Now Project Multimedia Educational Collectives. Tasneem Siddiqui is an assistant professor in the Department of History, Politics, and Social Justice at Winston-Salem State University, where she teaches courses that explores the ways of being, practices of resistance, and knowledge production throughout the African world. Hashtag HBCU's work. Our show was produced today in solidarity with the Native, Indigenous, African, and Afro-descendant communities at Standing Rock, Venezuela, Corporation Jackson in Jackson, Mississippi, Brazil, the Avalon Village in Detroit, Colombia, Kenya, Palestine, South Africa, and Ghana, and other places who are fighting for the protection of our land for the benefit of all peoples. Enjoy the program.
Professor Reese, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us today.
Thanks for inviting me.
So I have to say that I really appreciate our connection. I got connected with a mutual friend of ours, Sahat Walker, who did the beautiful cover art for your book. And so I want to give her a shout out for that.
Yeah, she gets lots of love.
Right. And just as a cultural producer in D.C. who has been in D.C. for many years and also lives in the neighborhood of Deanwood, which is the focus of your study. And so what I wanted to do is to first act really kind of, and this is a question that I like to ask folks, Would you walk us through some of your personal and intellectual trajectories? And what are the imperatives for your intellectual work and activism? I know you talk about growing up in East Texas, and there's so much when I was reading your book that really resonated with my own familial geographies and just growing around Black Southern food systems and foodways.
Yep. No, that's a great question. And I really appreciate that being the starting point because I don't know. I feel that I'm now at a point where I realize that so much of what I'm interested in intellectually is rooted in my family and community history. So as I mentioned in the book, I grew up in East Texas. I grew up in a family that had intimate connections with growing food. And also just grew up in a small town. And that for me is important because I think that's partly why I am interested in cities. So at this point, I've lived half of my life in cities, but the first half of my life, I was in this rural area. And then the first time I live in the city is when I went to college, which is also the first time that I think I started to really think about the kinds of specific inequities that cities produce. So I went to college in San Antonio, Texas. And San Antonio has a fairly small Black population. And I was doing some organizing and activism work around education in San Antonio on the east side, in a predominantly Black high school that was being threatened to be closed down. And so after that, I taught middle school, which is also featured in the book, and then ended up in my graduate education in DC. But I think a large part of what my intellectual trajectory has been focused on is kind of this tension between inequities that are produced by anti-Blackness, patriarchy, all of these kinds of structures that try to contain and keep people in place, and then the very creative and everyday strategies that people are using to navigate those structures. And I say tension because the creative ways that we navigate anti-Blackness doesn't do away with anti-Blackness, right? Like, it's still there. We can see it in all of its multifaceted ways, but it's still, there's still something very meaningful and valuable about the ways Black people create life. And that is an ongoing interest to me. So I'm thinking about the geography of place, sure, and I'm thinking about anti-Blackness, and I'm thinking about, but Black people are surviving in some kind of way, and how are we doing that? So I think that's probably going to be a question that I'm always interested in, and it might take lots of different forms. And of course, in this first book, it focuses on DC, but ultimately I'm interested in Black life.
And so much while I was reading your book, I was thinking about Clyde Woods, who is an ancestor and was a friend and mentor of mine. And I was thinking specifically about this article he wrote, Life After Death. And, you know, the ways in which he talks about how social science theory and methodology really anticipates the death of Black communities. In fact, it serves as like a mortuary of Black communities. However, you know, Woods is, really writing against this prediction of the death of Black communities and saying that it's premature.
Right.
And in fact, bound up with the logics of anti-Black racism and white supremacy.
Yeah.
And, you know, and so, you know, he's writing and as you are writing, talking about Black communities and Black people and taking it out of the realm of the institutions and organizations, but looking at the ways which, like, we're so much engaged in recreating and regenerating life-affirming systems. And then communities that are resisting these death-dealing system. So I wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, your methodology and how you're looking at Black geographies. And that's so important because it's a theoretical and methodological framework that comes out of global and localized indigenous knowledge systems of Africana people.
Yeah, this is also another great question. So when I was doing my PhD training, I was already interested in space and place. And my advisor, I have to give a shout out, Rachel Watkins at American University, at one point was like, for your dissertation, you're going to have to make some real choices around where you're going to align yourself theoretically. And so, you know, I finished the dissertation. And then by the time I was getting ready to start working on the book, there was this a lot of hype around what I now know to be Black geographies, right? And there was this reading list that was put out, and I had read Catherine McKittrick for the first time, which opened my eyes. Like, I read Catherine McKittrick and felt like I found a kindred. in the sense that she was not only just writing about material space, but like imaginative space and nostalgia and memory and all these things that Black people use to create workable geographies, or the things that other folks use to create unworkable geographies. And then it just led, I mean, I'm so glad you mentioned Clyde Woods, because also another person who has influenced my thinking, and Bobby Wilson, who's another geographer. Yes. So these folks were helping me think about geography in a way that I had never, you know, I thought about geography in the ways that you learn in high school. There are things on the map, I can point to them. You know, there are these material spaces, and they were helping me think about how my interest in Black studies might fit with thinking about space and place. And so there's a way that when I was doing my dissertation work, that my advisor had given me permission to be creative in how I went about doing the work. And she wasn't saying don't have a plan, but I just remember sitting down with her one day when I was feeling really stressed about the plan that I did have. Mm-hmm. And she just said, why don't you go to the field, go out into the field and listen and just see what you find. And that's pretty much exactly what I did. Like, I had a plan. In the first 4 months of me doing field work, that plan changed dramatically. And a lot of it was because of deep listening. And, you know, I'm an anthropologist. So anthropologists say that that's what we do all the time, that we go and we do field work and we listen deeply and we're like hanging out with people. But at the same time, a question that I was asking myself in the field was, am I willing to change everything that I say I'm doing based on what I hear? And my answer was yes, because deep inside me is this desire to lead with the stories of communities that I am working with. And to do that, that meant that I had this whole plan of that was more focused on consumption that I just threw out, because that wasn't what I was hearing from people when we were talking. And I always tell people that I am and have always been deeply inspired by Zora Neale Hurston. And in Dust Tracks on the Road, she's talking about her methods for going back to Florida and collecting these folktales from people, and how even though she's going back around communities that she's deeply familiar with, nobody wants to talk to her. And she has a moment where she realizes nobody wants to talk to her because she sounds like she just came from some like sedity place rather than being super grounded in community. And that for me feels like me, right? That when I go into the field and I'm doing work, I care much more about the people than the plan that I came in with. And I think that comes out in the book, and I hope it comes out in a lot more of the work that I do. That there are answers that I'm looking for, but if those answers have no relevance or meaning to the people that I claim to care about and love and serve, then I'm not as interested in those.
And like I said before, I mean, it did deeply resonate as I was reading the book, because all of these images, and I guess maybe this is also what you're talking about in terms of productive nostalgia, all of these images about, you know, how my grandparents made life, had gardens, how my mother, you know, shopped at 2 or 3 or 4 grocery stores just to get the sort of our basic necessities that were met. So all of that past, present, and future was really sort of coming together. And as someone that also engages Black geographies and a Black sense of place, you really illuminated a really important story. And I wanted to talk a little bit about, or ask you to, if you could frame your work. So you talk about Washington, D.C., but very specifically, you're outlining the history of the Deanwood neighborhood. Tell us about Deanwood.
So I found Deanwood by accident. I moved to D.C. I was a former teacher, and the skill that I wanted to give back, so to speak, was working with school-age children. I missed it. Like, I missed teaching, and so I was looking for opportunities to work with kids, and I was calling all of these different recreation centers, after-school programs, et cetera, to find a place. And when I called Deanwood, the person on the other end of the phone was like, can you come today? And I was like, huh, sure. So I drive to this neighborhood, was not anything related to my dissertation work initially. And I was volunteering there in the after school program. And one day the former director of the rec center was asking me about what I do. And I was telling him I was dissertation. I was working on a dissertation and I was trying to figure out something around food. And he said, have you ever thought about doing your research here? And I said, no, why would I do that? And he said, you should do a little bit of do a little research on the neighborhood and see what you think. And so when I did that, there were a couple things that were fascinating to me. One, so one of the DC public libraries keeps this bibliography of everything that is written about DC neighborhoods. And I'm flipping through and there's so much written about Shaw. There's so much written about Adams Morgan, Petworth, all these neighborhoods. And there were exactly four things on the bibliography that were written about Deanwood. And I was like, wow. And this was despite the fact that Deanwood had the only amusement park for Black people in the early 20th century, despite the fact that so many of the homes in Deanwood had historic significance because they were built by African-American architectures. All of these different things were happening, and I was super interested about it. And so Deanwood feels like a small little community. It feels a little insular. It's tucked into the northeast corner of the city. And lots of people have our second generation there. So their families have been there for a while. And that reminded me of home. And so that made me curious as well. Deanwood also has a lot of economic diversity within the neighborhood, even before gentrification, that I think is important and gets overlooked. This is also part of the reason why Black geographies matter. Like when we only look at things based on the numbers that someone else told us, we might totally forget that there's so much more diversity amongst Black people. So Deanwood is labeled a low-income neighborhood. It's technically a quote unquote food desert, if we wanted to use those terms. I don't use those terms. But then when you get deep inside of Deanwood, you see these connections. You see that people are living in the homes that their parents built or their parents had built. You see folks who come back and you see these high rates of home ownership. And that's what made it really curious to me, that this place can feel so stable and still also not have a supermarket.
And I want to talk about, kind of pull this thread on this erroneous conceptualization on food deserts, right? And what is made possible when we use a more apt conceptualization in terms of food apartheid, as articulated by Karen Washington, who was, you know, a food justice warrior.
Yes. Yeah. Karen is amazing. So my thinking on, first I'm going to say my thinking on labels and naming has changed so much over time. So when I started grad school, food desert was acceptable language, and I too just kind of adopted it because that was what was happening in the literature. And then I was in conversation with other scholars, and then at the same time I was doing field work and was feeling increasingly uncomfortable with how this term focused on a product and not a process. So, you know, people are talking about these neighborhoods, food deserts, there's nothing there. And that being separate from thinking about redlining or thinking about like racist practices that created these segregated spaces, or these practices that supermarkets use that are supposed to be race neutral or like they're not thinking about race, still kind of have implications for Black and communities of color. And so for me, food desert doesn't capture, even, you know, there was this point in time where I realized that food desert, even as a metaphor, wholly gets wrong what deserts do and how they function, even natural deserts, right? Like natural deserts have life. They have things that are teeming below the surface, and food deserts misses that because people are so focused on the supermarket aspect. And even though like a good part of the book focuses on supermarkets, that's partly why I also focus on the urban garden and also focus on the small store in the neighborhood, because I wanted to convey the point that in the absence of that, we're just remaking the ideas that Black spaces are nothing, that there's nothing happening, that they're uninhabited, uninhabitable. And I wanted to challenge that. And there are lots of other people who challenge that in other ways as well. But that's a part of that Black life thing for me, that just because I'm writing about what white supremacy has done to a Black neighborhood doesn't necessarily mean that I'm also can't write about life.
And I love this, you know, really focusing on there's so much that is happening. And for me, what I found was so much is happening is when we talk about care and forms of care. that really foreground and make possible the practices of self-reliance and how we think about community resilience and reconstitution. Can you talk more about these sort of forms of care that make possible the types of communities that people are regenerating and reconstituting, and really like the continuities of those communities?
Absolutely. And this is another moment where I have to give a shout out. And I think, well, in 2016, when her book In the Wake was published, Christina Sharpe's book In the Wake was published, it changed so much of my thinking and really like my intellectual life. So I'm grateful for it. And I love the way that in that book and in other spaces, she writes about care. Care being something that is different and apart from the kinds of quote unquote care that the state offers. And so in my book, I think that shows up especially in the ways that Mr. Jones, or who I call Mr. Jones in the book, tries to care for the kids by regulating what they'll buy. Now that can be patriarchal. It's a whole bunch of other things at the same time. But the children listen to him because they have a relationship with him and because of his relationship to the neighborhood. And then it shows up in this community garden. There are some things that I didn't write in the book, but one of them being that at the end of the month, there was a local resident who, if there were things left in the garden, he would take them and he would make these huge pots of soup, and he would make them for people in the community because by the end of the month, people's money had run out. And so like these kinds of ways that people are trying to look out for each other, these ways that people are trying to just make sure people's needs are met, giving rides to the supermarket is another form of care. I think I was trying to put it also in a historical context where Black people have always had these kind of care networks. And sure, some of it is out of necessity, but I think some of it is out of true desire to be in community with other people.
Some of it is really about love too. I mean, I have my students are always like, Dr. Siddiqui, when are we going to get it together as a community? And I'm like, what do you mean? I'm like, that's how we survive. That's how we get the, our day-to-day necessities too. And it's really in a lot of ways about that remembering, right? And that's the thing that I love when you have this concept of, and it's really, contradiction, a dialectic, a tension of nothingness that runs throughout the text. And it appears in policy initiatives. And how Deanwood community members, sort of their initial response, and when you ask them to talk about how they procure food, or if they, talking about sort of food systems and food ways, nothingness comes up first. But there are these deeper reflections that illuminate, Black geographies and communities. Yeah. Can you talk about that?
It was always so interesting to me. I would start and people would say, but there ain't no supermarkets here. There's nothing. And, that could have been the end of the conversation. And then I would learn about such and such garden, or I would learn about the store, or I learn all these things through talking to people. And I think I think you're right. We use the word productive. And I think it's true, because so much of policy is about fixing something or adding something. And maybe sometimes that could be good. And almost always, it is this kind of over-glossing of what is already happening within these spaces. So food deserts, and even the policies that we've had that have come out of like healthy food financing, the healthy food financing initiative on a large level, or even just the smaller things that community organizations sometimes want to do. I think a point that I wanted to make is that the most sustainable work that we can do has to be grounded in what we already know about communities and what they're already doing. It makes no sense to build something on it if we build it, they will come kind of model. I think that is patronizing in some ways, and it assumes that like people are wholly defined by the built environment. And that's not true. People have desires, they have preferences, they have goals for their lives. We have whole histories, and I think those kinds of things, even if we can't get all of them in policy, are things that should matter when we're crafting policy.
And I'm reminded, as you say that, of a conversation we had a few years ago with Fred Moten, who was talking about, talking about, curating it in terms of curacy as an act of care, and really, you know, protecting the things that we've already been doing, and make ourselves more conscious of that, kind of building that critical consciousness around. Listen, like we, and that was like the great thing, that when you had these conversations with folks, you know, and they would talk about nothingness, but then when they were sitting and sharing these stories, they're like, wait, you know, I mean, they probably, I don't know if they, I wasn't there, but if, you know, they were like, wait a second. But, you know, it was just this very deep reflection on like, well, you know, my grandmother or my aunt or my mother had a garden, right? And she, you know, she fed the neighborhood with her garden. And it's, these are just amazing, you know, amazing practices of caring for one another. And I think that that is so central to, and it's important to bring that into the work and how we write. And so you talk a lot about sort of engaged, I think it was engaged ethnography.
Engaged anthropology.
And how you bring this Black feminist praxis into the work that you're doing, and you're not outside of that.
Yeah, I think a thing that I've been thinking about over the last few years is many of us write about social relations, and we're observing social relations. We transcribe these interviews, and then we write them, write up these books and these articles. And I think over the last few years, I've been thinking about how to write myself as part of these social relations, but also how to have shared stake in what is happening. Because I'm not from DC, I didn't grow up in Deanwood. And I think that's normal for anthropology, that we go into a neighborhood or we go into a space and we do our work and then we leave. And I think that's unsettling for me in a number of ways. And I think Black feminist practice and praxis asks us to think very deeply about how we enter and how we leave spaces and the relationships that we build. And I remember having a moment when, because once you leave the field, and especially when you start, you know, teaching at a university, trying to stay in touch with people feels impossible. And I had a moment where I wanted to go back to talk to someone from my research, and I hadn't talked to him in about 2 years. And I felt guilty. Like, I felt really bad that I hadn't been in touch. I email him. I feel nervous when it's time to call him, and I call him. And I'm like apologizing that I hadn't been in touch. And the thing that he said to me, he was like, you know, you've got a life. We know you've got a life, but we also know that you care. You don't have to worry. Like, I wouldn't have ever talked to you if I didn't think that you cared. And it struck me, because it was a moment where I also realized that, oh, there's some unlearning that I have to do too as a researcher, because he's, and I hadn't thought about the fact that, like, he did and always did have agency in our relationship with each other, to the point where, yeah, he could have chosen never to talk to me. And so I think that's a part of my Black feminist praxis, is thinking about the power dynamics and what assumptions I'm doing or making when I'm doing the research. But I also think that Christina Sharp writes about, she says that we need to be attending to new modes of thinking and writing. And we need to be extending our imaginations in terms of the kind of work that we're producing as scholars, as activists, as artists. And I think that's something I take very seriously. I'm thinking about that in terms of what my investment is in different projects that aren't just intellectual. Like, what are my investments in the community and people, in the work that can be produced even beyond the work that I produce. And I think that that's a part of a Black feminist ethic, to really consider like how we're connected, right? And to reject these ideas of objectivity by writing ourselves as part of the narrative.
And you had a piece at the end in your conclusion where you talked about grief and sort of being in that space. Because, you know, for us as people of African descent, we can't take, even though, you know, you're not originally from Deanwood, or even the communities that I'm in relation with, I'm not originally from those communities, but there's so many deep resonances in terms of the precarity of Black life, and then how we make life and celebrate life. And so, you know, what do some of those new modes look like for you?
Yeah, so you mentioned the grief part in the conclusion, and I think even writing about that grief in this public way felt like a mode, right? I think that we, attend to grief publicly in all of these different ways, like social media and all of that. But I could have written that whole book and never referred to that specific death at all, because it seemingly it had nothing to do with the rest of the content of the book. And for me, it had everything to do with it. Like, I was so struck by who I named Kaylin in the book. I was so struck by his death and so struck by the idea that there was even, you know, he was doing all the right things and still could get murdered in the middle of the night. And I think that is part of where I was starting to really think about the interlocking and sometimes overwhelming parts of anti-Blackness, and to only write about food access without including this kind of, in some ways, memorializing this death in the last chapter felt wrong to me. And then I think the other new ways for me, I'm working on a new project now that has to do with prisons and agriculture. And part of it is, it's a project that has kind of been knocking around in my head for a while now, probably at least the last 10 years. And so now I have space and time to do it. But part of the project is me reckoning with my own personal relationships to prisons and incarceration. And part of it is trying to get us all to reckon with our connections to prisons and carcerality vis-a-vis food, because the U.S. has a history of using history and contemporary practice.
We are currently listening to Africa Now and Africa Woke Now Project Collective, Tasneem Siddiqui, in conversation with Ashanté Reese. We are currently having the privilege to sit and listen to the minds of deeply intelligent, action-oriented educators think through Black geographies, the right to food, memories of resistance, and the role of land in the scope and range of Africana freedom. Ashanté Reese is an assistant professor in the Department of Geography and Environmental Sciences at University of Maryland, Baltimore County. Ashanté earned her bachelor's degree in history with a minor in African American Studies from Trinity University in San Antonio, Texas. She later went on to earn her master's in public anthropology and a PhD from American University, specializing in race, gender, and social justice. Her work is situated around Black geography, specifically the ways Black people produce and navigate spaces and places in the context of anti-Blackness. While she is interested in and committed to documenting the ways anti-Blackness constrains Black life, her ultimate intent is to seek answers to the question, what and who survives? Including being a valued member of the Africa Now and Africa Woke Now Project's Multimedia Educational Collective, Tasneem Siddiqui is an assistant professor in the Department of History, Politics, and Social Justice at Winston-Salem State University, where she teaches courses that explores the ways of being, practices of resistance, and knowledge production throughout the African world. Hashtag HBCU's work. Our show is produced today in solidarity with the Native, Indigenous, African, and Afro-descendant communities at Standing Rock, Venezuela, Corporation Jackson in Jackson, Mississippi, Brazil, the Avalon Village in Detroit, Colombia, Kenya, Palestine, South Africa, and Ghana, and other places who are fighting for the protection of our land for the benefit of all peoples. Continue to enjoy the program.
History of using, history and contemporary practice of using prison labor in our food system. And so there are these ways that I'm trying to, in my work, think about drawing the personal and the political and the seemingly abstract more closer together for myself as a researcher, but also for a reader.
And I'm thinking about two instances. Like, I grew up in the Inland Empire in California. And so, you know, it's one of the most carceral facilities in the country. And I grew up in a city where simultaneously you had five different carceral facilities, one that was like down the street from our high school. And then at the same time, you had this agriculture It was an agricultural mm-hmm. community, you know. And then the mm-hmm. other thing, and, you know, cattle ranches and all the sort, and the other thing that I'm thinking about as well, even students here at Winston-Salem State University, who they very much, you know, live in a context of food apartheid. I have students all the time that are talking about, Dr. Siddiqui, we want fresh fruits and vegetables. We want more options. But then the distributor that, you know, the food distributor here is Aramark, which also uses prison labor. And so them trying to think about how do we organize, or how can we start to push for different options or different choices for ourselves that we desperately want and desperately need.
And it's so tough, because I think the thing that I'm trying to work through in this next project that is very different from the last project are just the multiple layers. So if my first book was about this kind of very deep neighborhood study, in a sense, this other project is really kind of thinking through the local and global connections between carceral institutions and these big companies that we now know, right? And trying to make those connections very plain. And then also looking for rupture points. Where have people been able to organize, like your students are wanting to do? How have people organized, especially people who are currently incarcerated? How have they used food as a tool of resistance? You know, these are the kind of the questions that I am thinking about, because, yeah, like these kinds of, you mentioned, you know, where you grew up. I grew up within an hour of 9 state prisons. You know, that was a part of my everyday life. And I think that is also part of the bringing me writing. Christina Sharp, I'm always talking about her because really that book changed my life. But like the idea that she writes in terms of writing ourselves into a we that is Black and global, I think that's part of what I'm doing. I'm thinking about the we and what is my role, and like how am I complicit in the we, or how am I engaging in the we in terms of writing food and writing Blackness and writing anti-Blackness. So yeah, like I think your students, I mean, I'm smiling because so much of the thinking that we are doing and need to be doing does happen with young people.
Absolutely. And providing and helping them, guide them towards developing that critical consciousness.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And so, you know, and you mentioned something in terms of like the global, and I was thinking about what you understand as the global scope of your work. And I'm thinking, and I just read this article over the weekend, Why Food Systems Are Breaking Down Across the World. And, you know, they're talking about very much, you know, the infiltration of supermarkets, how that's connected to, you know, these major corporations, Monsanto's, Coca-Cola, and the ways in which that is supplanting, really violently attempts to violently supplant the indigenous foodways and local mm-hmm. agricultural practices. And you talk mm-hmm. about Dean Wood as, you know, could be in any American city, right? But then I'm mm-hmm. thinking about what is the global scope as we see really in the last 2 decades, the real infiltration of supermarkets in Africa, in Latin America, in Asia.
Yeah, no, I think supermarkets are, one of the things I like to tell people about supermarkets is that we readily depend on them, and increasingly so globally, but we don't have to, like we have a whole history that predates supermarkets. And I think that's an important thing for people to think about and to understand. And supermarkets are, for the consumer, can be very convenient. But then what we've seen over the last, at least the last 15, 20 years, is just these large multinational corporations, these conglomerates that are huge and aren't just running supermarkets, but then end up having all these subsidiaries that are operating globally. And so one of the things that I'm inspired by a few projects. There's a project in South Africa, a Black feminist food project in South Africa, that I really love watching, because they're, part of their work is obviously critique, but there's this other part of the work that is archiving and celebrating and thinking about exactly what you're saying, these indigenous food ways. And what I am inspired by are folks who are doing whatever it takes to try to preserve those. And I think that in that way, we have to make choices. I mean, I think that it comes down to that. We have to make choices about what we consume, where we consume, and how we prioritize that. That is not me saying that a consumer is that we're responsible for what's happening in our food systems. But I do think that part of what happens is that we are almost wholly alienated from where things are produced and how they circulate on a global scale. So much so that, like, it's not just the supermarket piece that you point out, but I think part of the reason indigenous foodways are breaking down as well is the global labor regime that privileges Western countries like the US, like European nations. And people are working for low amounts of wages so that they can produce for us to consume over here. And then what happens? That makes space for these companies like McDonald's is on the top of my head because it's one of the first ones that has been able to, like, just literally be almost everywhere in the world. It makes space for companies like that to peddle their cheap goods and cheap foods. And in that way, we're all bound up in that.
And it's so much about the struggle for land too, right? And preserving and protecting ancestral lands, not in a way of, in terms of thinking about, you know, racial capitalist ownership of land, but really thinking about continuities of indigenous lifeways, indigenous knowledge systems. And so, you know, and you mentioned that too. And I'd like you, maybe if you could meditate a little bit with me about thinking about, you know, because a lot of my work is also about land, Black farmers mm-hmm. and land and their relationships to land.
Land is, this is great. Like, land is such a struggle for me to think about as a question, because I think who owns or who is stewarding land matters. And I think intellectually, it is often really hard for me to even think about the fact that we parcel up the earth and sell it.
Right.
And, like, you know, I know that sounds so simple and naive maybe, but, like, it is very, very hard. It's so hard. I'm like, this is a practice. Like, this is what we do. And even with the organizers and activists that I'm blessed to be in community with, I think this is something that we all struggle with trying to do work that is about increasing Black farmland and preserving Black farmland when we also all probably fundamentally don't believe in land ownership mm-hmm. in a lot of ways. So in the work that I do, that's less research and more just the kind of community activists and advocacy work with Black farmers, I think this is a thing that we are always thinking about. And I think we've landed on the idea that we can do the political education around helping people be in right relationship with land, but first we got to have it. You know, like, we've got to be able to protect it. And I think that that is even more true as we're thinking about, I guess, what some people would call climate change, but we might actually need to be thinking about impending, like, disasters, right? Potential disasters. Who owns land is going to matter. And I think that we want to have people who are community-minded protecting and stewarding those spaces. I have been on a number of farms, Black farms in the South, and I am often very inspired by the creative things that people are doing, not just growing, but building houses, tiny houses on their land so that people can live there. And I'm inspired by, like, these kind of rural urban connections that people are trying to make with rural farmers, allowing urban, you know, folks, landless, what some people call landless farmers, to come and grow on their land. I think we need more of that. Like, those are things that are happening. And I think there needs to be more elevation of those kinds of things. And then there's Soulfire Farm, who has the whole reparations project around land, or has been organizing it, to put people in conversation with each other, white folks in conversation with people of color, to acquire, you know, gift and give back land that people can use for growing and building community. So that was like a long-winded answer, but I do. I think land is important. I think who's stewarding the land is important. And I think, but I do think we cannot lose the political education piece, so that the land ownership isn't just about me as an individual, but that we're really thinking collectively about what is possible.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And then, you know, like, and that preservation of our indigenous knowledge systems around farming and relationships to land, you know, that now get kind of characterized as agroecology. But at the same time, I'm like, no, we've been doing this for thousands and thousands of years where, you know, rightly, as you said, you know, the idea of parceling up land was so diametrically opposed in terms of, like, you know, cosmological systems and ontological systems.
Yep. Yeah. And I think the other thing that I've been reading, Tiffany King's The Black Shoals. Mm-hmm. And I think a part of my thinking about land too has been inspired by, or at least is continually being inspired by, thinking through indigenous and black connections, indigenous communities in the US and like African diaspora communities being in conversation with each other. And I'm not sure that, at least for me, I haven't experienced a bunch of spaces where that kind of conversation has been possible in a way that isn't mitigated by like the white gaze, right? Or mitigated by this constant fight for land, because we're all in this fight for land. So anyway, I just mentioned the Black Shoals. It's given me a lot to think about in terms of colonization, white supremacy and such, and how that's influenced some of the conversations that we are and are not having across lines of difference.
And I've really loved this conversation. It's been so productive and generative for my thinking. And as I wrap up, I wanted to think about, and maybe you can talk about this a little bit. You know, when we think about food sovereignty, food access, I mean, this is one part of a much larger global human rights struggle, specifically for people of African descent around, you know, housing as a living right, as a human right, you know, gentrification or impending gentrification, criminalization, economic precarity and instability, you know, paramilitary violence. And I wanted, you know, if you could talk to us a little bit about, you know, Black food futures and like the place, and you had mentioned this in your conclusion, but, you know, the place of food in our Black liberation movements and the importance of food, because it is so connected to all of those different processes.
So another moment where we give a shout out. I was so excited about Monica White's Freedom Farmer.
Yeah.
And what I read as kind of a revision to how we've thought about freedom movements, because she puts farmers at the center and talks about the ways farmers put themselves at risk, put their land up for collateral, all these things in service to these large movements that we think about today, like the civil rights movement. And so for me, part of Black Food Futures includes this kind of text that Monica writes, which is us being willing to rethink the ways that we've thought about freedom movements and food's role in freedom movements. So that's first thing. The second thing is I was also inspired by the, you know, a few years ago when the movement for Black Lives included land and food in their platform, because I hadn't seen a movement that wasn't food-based do that in, you know, in my adult life. And I was very encouraged by that, because I think the more that we keep separating these issues from each other, the harder it gets to really thinking about people as whole lives, you know, and people's whole lives and what they need. Because quite frankly, like, the same communities that are experiencing over-policing are also likely experiencing food apartheid and all the health disparities that the CDC cites that affect Black people. All these things are happening at the same time. And so for me, food futures is thinking about food in context. Black food futures means thinking about food in context. I think Black land, saving and preserving Black land is a part of that. There's a whole new generation of farmers that are being trained right now that I'm really excited about. I think that's part of it. But I also think, I do think that we have to think a lot about infrastructure. If we don't want these large multinational corporations, what do we want and how do we build that? And I think again, thinking about Monica's book, we have a model to think through cooperatives. What would that look like? And I think we should also consider how do we want to, like, what does right relationship look like? Does it look like having these smaller stores on a very local scale? I really don't know, but I do think Black Food Futures has to really grapple with being creative in terms of food's connection with these other things. I mean, that's also a part of the reason why I was interested in looking at food at the intersection of incarceration, because I think we have to highlight these intersections very specifically more in our activism and in our research. And who knows what's going to come of that research? I don't know. But for me, it's not just about narrating even more of the atrocities of prisons, but it's more like, how do we, Catherine McKittrick writes about how these spaces of encounters also have some decolonial jewels for us in them. And that's what I'm looking for. How do we find these kind of decolonial practices that we can use to continue to rupture these systems?
Right. And then our analysis of racial violence we can't be so over-focused on that aspect and not see, like, what strategies, what tactics, what you're talking about, these sort of, like,
yes,
decolonial possibilities, right? These Black geographies, this,
yes,
Black sense of space that emerges, right? And that,
yes,
has been there always, you know?
Right. And I kind of just see myself, I'm not a historian by training, but I do think that we have a responsibility. I feel a responsibility for thinking through the continuities and the disconnects from, like, historical moments to the present. Not necessarily linearly, but, like, I do think that we have things that we can learn. And I'm a student of the past, of a student of history, and in thinking through how do we move forward.
And really engaging our living traditions as well. I mean, I teach in the history department,
yep,
but I'm not a historian. So I feel you.
Yes.
Yeah, no, exactly. I love this conversation. Thank you so much for joining us. I wanted to see, do you have some closing thoughts that you want to share with our audience? And I think part of it is that, you know, we think about the work that we do in academia, especially here at Africa World Now Project and our media collective. On the one hand, it is descriptive and it's diagnosing, but on the other hand, the other part of that is prescriptive. And that's something that you had mentioned as well when you're talking about engaged anthropology as well, like doing this, mm-hmm, research, but then finding ways in which, you know, we should be looking at social problems, local and global social,
yep,
problems, and then how we find solutions.
Yeah, I feel pretty strongly about this these days. By the time I finished writing the book, I realized that it is really hard to be exasperated or just angry all the time. And to me, what combats that is being connected to organizations and groups that are doing work that I believe in. And that has really fundamentally changed things for me, so that I'm not just, like, talking about what's wrong all the time. I can look to, you know, Patchwork Farm in Atlanta or Saffron or, like, all these different places in these different organizations, and see that there are some folks who are doing the work. And I think if there's anything I would put out there for people who are interested in food, food justice, food sovereignty, at some point, it's not just theoretical. At some point, you just got to get your hands in the work. And that's what keeps me going. I have intellectual interest in these things, but really what keeps me going is being connected to comrades who are doing really dope work all the time and who I get to do dope work with. I think there are no freedom dreams unless they're collective.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great way to close. Thank you so much again, Ashanté Reese, for taking the time to speak with us. And I look forward to more conversations with you.
Yes, thank you for inviting me.
That's it for Africa World Now Project for this week. I would like to thank you for joining us today and look forward to spending time with you next week. We can be reached through all your regular social media platforms. Email africaworldnowproject@gmail.com or follow us on Twitter @AFWRLDNWPRJ. I'm your host and producer, James Pope. The Africa World Now Project Collective consists of international media journalist, executive producer, and human rights activist, Moise Mutale, Africa World Now Project media correspondent, Funda Ngunda, senior research, content contributor, and production director, Dr. Tasneem Siddiqui, senior researcher, and content contributor and production associate, Dr. Josh Myers, associate producer and content contributor, Dr. Keisha Khan Perry, technology advisor is Byron Gray of GrayWorks Technology, and creative director is Judah Pope. Africa World Now Project is heard every Wednesday at 7 p.m. on WSNC, NPR affiliate and broadcasting service of Winston-Salem State University. Shows are archived weekly on SoundCloud. Search Africa World Now Project. Until next week, be safe, be peaceful, and above all, be intelligent.
Yeah, it's like this, though. Yeah, check it out. Yeah, somebody told me it's the end of the world, but that's just for some. Peace to the dead, strength to the chosen. Quicksand, millennium, quicksand, millennium. Check it out. It's like somebody told me it's the end of the world, but that's just for some. Peace to the dead, strength to the chosen. Quicksand, millennium. Check it out. Quicksand, millennium. Hey, yeah. Here comes the SP factor, passion, the task of Wilson and Southwark. Seven for Snyder Ave to Uptown, to Martin Luther King Dome. Y'all cross the tracks back to the ozone. Classic hip-hop thump from every road home. Niggas on a hunt for chunk to get the cows on, making a milestone. Some of them are crabs in costume, zoning to the sound of a cellular dial tone. Go ahead, increase the level, get your ear canal blown. To each his own, y'all clones praise the unknown. I'm paying on this fallout shelter slash home, cause it ain't won't come. This revolution's full blown. Everyday ghetto with tire combat uniform. Another soldier just got clapped the other morn. I seen him on the cover of the Daily News. Yo, I can barely move. My little cousin Hassan, South Philly turning into Kuwait. What's going on? Welcome into the quicksand, millennium. It's like somebody told me it's the end of the world, but that's just for some. Peace to the dead, strength to the chosen. Quicksand, millennium. Check it out. Quicksand, millennium. Millennium. Check it out. Somebody told me it's the end of the world, but that's just for some. Peace to the dead, strength to the chosen. Quicksand, millennium. Quicksand, millennium. Millennium.
Fusion brought about by this one-eyed beast. When will the madness cease? For now, we kick you with cleats. Soon as you let your guard down, some they try to throw one. Nobody's total toe when that shit is played, they run for guns. So what am I, the good guy? I cock, think not. We could both drop and then our graves finish the plot. Transform the evil and deceive you, know just where to leave you. Your soul is deficient like mine, finish the crime. Define all its attributes, it's 99. Ways to exit, choose one and your view's done. We cling to this world, stalking diamonds and pearls. But when the earth earls up in the rock, we'll get struck. Ignoring the signs, all the whispers from Shaitan. Eternal, a bold, a flame situation. Somebody told me it's the end of the world, but it's just for some. Peace to the dead, strength to the chosen. Quicksand millennium, yo, the quicksand millennium. Somebody told me it's the end of the world, but it's just for some. Peace to the dead, strength to the chosen.